great pleasure for me to introduce Tao Cheng again, because first of all, because she remembered me several experience developed together more or less 10 years ago in this group chaired by Miguel Kareski, and Miguel Kareski was keynote in 2014, probably most of you remember in Marrakesh. This is a group inside S4 for chaired by Dennis Pumay, also keynote in 2008 in Perugia in ICCSA. And this group is about environmental analysis, environmental analytics, using geostatistics and urban modeling. Tao Cheng is at the same time the founder and the director of the SpaceTimeLab on Big Data Analytics at the University College of London. And the aims of this lab is to analyze the urban resilience and sustainability. Despite the age,
she's so young.
She published more than 2,000 papers in important journal, and she directed a lot of important projects, also with industrial partners. But you are here not for listening to me, but for listening to her. And I don't want to waste more time, and I invite Tao Cheng to start with his speech.
Would you prefer this or this? Probably this.
Thank you. Thank you, Daniela. So it's my great pleasure, as been said. I met him almost 10 years ago when I just started my job in London. So it's nice to be here. So I'm still surprised. We still have people here. We have a last very fun night last night. So thank you for coming, for making efforts to come here to listen to my talk. So I love the title of my talk. It's about big data and smart cities. So I want to have a look first. What's the smart city? Because now they said big data and smart seems a very popular word, and there's so many different definitions you might find about smart city. So what means smart city? I mean, the tons of them. I think the keywords I want to show here is it's connected, it's instrumental, it's with sensors, and also got to be intelligent. Okay, so really smart sort of means intelligent. So I think that's my interpretation about smart city. About smart, what is intelligent? What is intelligence? Actually means you can make, to know what's going to happen in the future. Okay, so make a prediction. And only to know that, actually, that means you only know the trend. And actually, you should be able to know how you react on it. That means we know what might happen and how we react to it, but you may say our reaction may be overreact or be not enough. So you have to adjust your action. Sometimes say, I check the weather. Seems to be extremely hot. Okay, oh, I thought it's really, really hot. But actually it was really quite cool. But today actually it's relatively warm. So in a way, below the trend, it's going to be warm. But it may still have a little bit of adjustment to be done. So that's the kind of intelligence what it means. You know what's going to happen, and you make a reaction, but actually you're going to make that just action. But smart cities, I mean cities is so big topic. I'm not an expert on it at all. The urban planners here, so, but to say, really means to say, the city is broad, so it can cover almost everything, I would say. So, but in my case, I'm not going to talk about everything, because as Benjamin Yang also said, I have a lab which is called a SpaceTimeLab. Why I call it a SpaceTimeLab? Because when I started from spatial analysis, then moved to spatial temporal analysis. So I tried to find a piece of model. I started with a forest fire prediction. Then, can I find a model which I can do the modeling easily? Then I suddenly realized it's not of a choice there. It's only SD River. It's the only model actually there. And there's lots of limitation about that model. So I started from there. So So why we have no much model to do the space-time together? So that's why I have this lab. So what do we do actually? So this you can read it. What do we do related to smart city? That's what we are trying to say. We cover my lab mostly cover four things right now. One is transport and mobility. I think that's the fundamentals of any smart city. You go anywhere, you talk about smart. So the one thing is related to transport. Okay, so transport. And another aspect is about safety and security. I think that's also very, very important at the current climate. Of course, always important, but now I think it's more crucial, especially I came from London recently, I've lost a terrorist attack. And the third one is about the environmental resilience. That means to say all the natural hazards, the critical infrastructure, how we better protect them, how we can understand what's the risk of those critical infrastructure. And also another one is about business intelligence. Okay, so if you think about transport for the wider infrastructure to move people around, and people do business, people work, and of course you also want to say, yes, how we can promote the business. So that's kind of four major areas I've been working on since I've been in sales. So quite busy, taking 11 years actually. 1st of July is my 11 years in UCL. So basically I would like to, I would like to focus on these four areas. So as you can see, there's four projects actually underlying all these four areas. So that's the thing I'm going to talk about here today. So in terms of transport, I started with Transport for London. We have project which really, last time I started is in 2009. A lot of time, iPhone is not popular, and Google don't have any data within N25 within central London. So that's when I started. When I finished it, and Google have data inside London as well, because everyone is using iPhone. So we did a few things, basically. So I'll show you some examples. So this is one about the transport. I mean, one of the things is say, you know, we all have a smartphone, so you have a GPS devices with your phone. So from the your side is left, right? Left side can say is, the white dot is basically GPS dots. So you really don't know what you are doing. So what are we trying to do say, can we know it right now you're sitting here, or you're on the bus, or you're on the cycle and bicycle, or you're walking in the park. So the difficulty for this is to say, if you are in a very busy street, like London, and even like today we're driving, we couldn't get any signal sometimes because of the buildings. So for those difficulty things, so you might be able to say, yeah, actually I can detect hybrid mode, especially for very, very busy road. So basically, compared with other people say, yes, it's no problem, you can easily get it in highway, you know, proper road, but if there's no pass, you're walking in the park or cycling. So that's the challenge we have. So that's one of the PhD students' work. So what's the implication? Lots of implications, because now can to extract the GPS track is so easy and simple. So from that, you can see where people are strictly speaking, which transport mode they're using. So if you're doing transport planning, you should be able to know. Actually, you can use it a lot for urban planning as well. You can know where people's home if you really got lots of information about it. It's possible in China, probably not in, at least not in UK or in Europe, because we can't easily hold for every data set. Another thing we have done is transport road surface about journey time prediction. So on that, yes. So the first slide I really want to show you is, yes. So this is journey time prediction. What's special about it is that we use with cameras to get the journey time of one segment. But in the camera, two situations, camera can't get any data. One is broken, and everything is old, so easily broken. So no data, missing data. Another situation, when it's highly congested, you probably also have low data. So lots of missing data. And I don't know, I think yesterday I was in a talk, someone talked about special temporal time theories. Okay, so we in the modeling, you know, time theories is missing that last challenge. So we managed using some machine learning approach to cover this issue. Another situation is easily if we said no highly congested situation, just no peaks, it's easy to predict for any statistical vector. But if you have highly congested situation, so when you have peaks, highs and lows, and that's difficult to predict as well. So that's the thing we have done specially in this case. So busy vector and the peaks. And on the right one is basically, this is a simulation, I think. So this is simulation, so what's unique about this simulation? Transport simulation, everyone is doing it. So what's unique about this one? This one is we're using 30 real OD, original destination of people in London. And we used the real road finding behavior. And we use real road layout and real constraint as well. Only thing we can say that is the traffic light can time. So everything else is all true. Okay. So basically, we are able to do the largest scale of the simulation, and also you can really it's very close to the real behavior. So how we can get that, basically we use a taxi company which is called Edison Lee. They have taxi driver data and we try to learn their behavior. Now you ask me, taxi driver was very different from commuters, which is absolutely true, and it was very different from the tourists. So that's the way we're trying to learn, okay? And so if you can really understand the behavior of the drivers, then probably you're more closer to seeing why there's traffic congestion, okay? So another thing, public transport. So underground, London is old, the tube station is about over 150 years old. So maintenance in the weekend is a normal routine. So how those weekend engineering work impact on people's daily life. So that's the kind of evaluation we'll be able to do with the data. So basically we have all the data analyzing, say, how many people will not going to do their weekend activity because of this maintained work. How many people are going to change it to other lines? So how many people are going to change to other modes? How many people are going to use other stations? So for all of this, it's all possible to be accessed. Then you can also, so if you say, because in London, even the tube station is closed, or a particular line is going to be closed for a particular station, there's always replacement bus. So where to put the bus, how frequent those bus arrangement. So based on the information we just got, you can understand how one station or one line has problem, how you have impact on others. So you can learn from your data. So that's what we're able to do, okay? And another thing is the morning peak. Morning peak is always a problem for any city, okay? Same thing on the tube, so there's several lines, extremely busy, like the Victoria line, Northern line, in London. So in the morning peak, basically we're talking about 8:15 to 8:30 is the most congested time period. So we also study the demand. So the peak demand is always double the demand in the normal time. Okay, it's almost like a relationship. So how you manage that? So actually, TfL actually said, can we persuade people not to travel at the morning peak? Do you think it's possible or not? So it's really, really congested. Guys, can you not travel in the peak time? How many people will say yes or no? You may say, depends, right? So actually before they just say, okay, this is very congested station. This is a literally travel people. Actually, the several stations are close by, and there's several, many, many bus service close by. And you know, the most congested time is just the time window. If you don't travel this time, actually life will be easy for everyone. Does it work? No, right? No, okay. I said, okay, put the word, right? So actually, can we make the job relatively more intelligent? Can we really tell the people the information to the people could able to make the change. So that's what we do in this particular project, MSA project. So we're trying to identify the people who might have flexible traveling behavior. What it means? That means they might able to travel at a different time, they might have used other tube stations close by, other bus lines close by. So in this way, we can really identify the people who might have chance to change. Because for some people, if their job has to be the office precise and long clock, they have to use like a particular tube station, they're not able to change, right? So some people like me might possibly, you can say, most academics, if you come to the office, you don't have any morning 9 o'clock meeting like today, you can come a little bit late, which might be possible. So that's a possibility there. And housewife or other people going shopping or older people, that's all possible. So in this way, we're able to identify those flexible travelers. So yes, because in TFL, if you're a resident, you buy our voice card, which is a card used in London, so they have your email address. So they can send this kind of information to you. And then whenever there's a line has a problem relevant to your daily travel, actually now they haven't been able to choose, but they're now getting rather more smart. So it's something wrong with my life that I use every day. They will send you an email, how do you say something wrong with it, okay? So that can make us more intelligent. So that's one thing. So that's basically, it's more based on the data, we're trying to understand travel behaviors. So how we can even push it even more. So that's the next thing we're doing is not only analyzing the travel behavior, actually I want to analyze the people, because no matter what the behavior you have, why you have that behavior, actually it's relevant to who you are, right? As I said, can you have flexible travel, but depending on your which kind of job you got, what kind of family setting you have, because you have to send the kids to the school in the morning, then there's a job you have to be done with picking them up, okay? So age, lifestyles, is all relevant. So, can we understand the people from their travel behaviors? So that's the things we've also been doing quite a lot in the past 2 years that we're trying to focus on. So this is one of the examples there, based on the voice card data. And the word, I hope everyone knows, voice card is the card we use in London, okay? TF is Transport of London, who is managing the transport in London. So what we call here, actually it's two kinds of data. So the one is the voice card you have, okay, so that everyone have one. And another data set is from TfL, is London Travel Demand Survey, LTDS data set. For that data set is an annual survey. Every year, TfL survey about 8,000 households. Anyone age over 11, they also be joined for this survey. So they ask them all kind of social demographic information, age, you know, age, gender, income, family, all kinds of things, okay? So basically, based on that, they can try to understand the travel demand. So they also ask those people, are you willing for us to give your survey data with your Oyster card? So some people say yes. So in that way, we have two data sets. One is the social demographic information. Another one is their travel data, daily travel data. So in this way, we can link them up. So from that, actually we are able to analyze their travel behavior. So this is example, say, so if you look at that, so if you look at the very light night blue, yes. So this light blue, okay, if you look at the income here, you can see this very light one applies the income, okay? And then you have this relatively dark blue, right? It's relatively still quite a good income, but relatively lower than the light blue, okay? And then of course the green one have the lowest income, but if you look at the age, they're basically retired people. So that's very easy for you guys to understand from this. Income, age, and car ownership, okay? But actually what the travel pattern is showing here, actually, if you look at the light blue one, basically this is morning peak, okay? When they travel in the morning peak, and the morning peak, and this evening. So that means those, these people, these guys, have very, very regular evening and morning. actually they are the highest paid professionals, okay? Because we're, you know, where this is really talking about from the data we got of this 8,000 household, but we have several years, so about 20,000 individuals, okay? So that's that. And then you can see this is basically, this red one is basically some part-time, some students are very mixed, okay? So this is just to give some general idea, say, you see my back today to people, let me see they, this red group, okay? They have more people very, very relatively late. But this one, this is travel rate, sorry. This means that they travel a lot in the early morning peak, okay? So basically, so what do we do? That's the information you can get from the survey, and this is some patterns you find from your voice card. So we try to build a connection between these two. So of course, the expression is how accurate it could be, okay? This is the work we did last year. So now we have actually more advanced result. So the most challenging one is not to find out these people, okay? It's not difficult to find this big age group difference, because in London actually they have all different kinds of voice card type. So if you're 11, you don't really need to pay if you're in school, okay? But below 11, if you're above, you have different kind of cards. The most challenging one is to understand from someone like me, so let me just say you can age from above 18 to 65. So there's a huge range, and within this range, there's so many social demographic information there. So how you can make it more subtle? So what kind of personal profile would be? So that's the work we are pushing, okay? So we have some result that I didn't show you here. It's really interesting I have behind these slides. So, well, that's a challenge, as you can see. We are able to get this one quite accurately, say 80%, go to the very, very generic time. But to push it further down is hard. Why we're doing that? Because it's end of the day, TFL want to know how many people are using the pushchair in this stage at this time. How many people need to use disabled facilities? Because the space in the tube station is very, very limited. So how you better manage your service? So that's what they want to know the people. So if we know well those people, who are those people, actually, we're also able to profile in the stations. For example, I don't know how many people have ever been to UCL. How many people have ever been to London? Oh, we say almost everyone been to London, hopefully. Oh, yeah, quite a few, okay? So if you have been to London, so I'm showing here two stations. One is Water Street, one is Oxford Circles. Water Street is a station very close to UCL. Okay, so if you've been to London, so UCL basically they've long been here, lots of that's why you see lots of very high paid professionals actually around UCL. We also have hospitals, okay? And then Oxford Circles, I also told a Chinese friend, if you want to shop to place, why go to Oxford Circles? It's a shopping place, right? Another place, go to Westfield, okay? Which is close to my house. So Oxford Circles, so basically what you can show you in the morning, early morning, you can see the more high paid, you know, white professionals in Water Street and red less than Oxford Circles, okay? But then in the evening, the situation slightly changed. So what it means, that means really different stations, they do have different people in and out at different times. So in this way, really, because for TFL, they have data, they have so much amount of data, but they really want to know what's the general pattern. That's the challenge, actually. It's not the data, it's basically they want to know precisely this thing today, what are they think is going to happen. So they want to have a very generic picture. That's we're trying to figure out what is generic picture for this particular station, how this one is different from another. So that's what we're doing, okay? So, another one is about, say, understanding people further, okay? Push it further. Travel demand, right? So we have every year 80,000 households. However, we have the oyster cup. Can we push it further? Do we really need to do this annual survey? Or this annual survey is good enough? So how can we make use of the oyster cup with the surveying data set? So this is the one, also, which is we try to understand where people work, where is their home. So basically, it's another PhD student's work. So, lots of heuristic analysis and combine the location, combine duration, combine the frequency, lots of things behind this. So you can try to identify the home location and work location. And then, so what's the difference between this work and that paper's work? We compare it with someone else's work and we find the accuracy is better. But even so, even if it's better, it's still 80% or 60%. So still not good enough, okay? So that's the reason we keep on pushing. Okay, it's better than what's before, but it's still space to do. But more than that, it's only easy to identify the home and the work. But what is lacking? What's the secondary, we call it important activity, okay? So that's the thing, is what she's working on. So I think the final bit about the transport is about cycling, okay? So I think I have so many cycles or bikes here today or yesterday, but London, I think many major big cities in China are also pushing the cycling very, very hard, the green transport. So one of the challenges is on that is basically, I don't know if anyone of you guys use Ostrava. Ostrava is an app. So basically, the company connects all the private cyclists tracks. Okay, so what my colleague is doing is basically trying to combine their data with TFLs. They have their data about what they have, some county data, and also really try to combine together with the flow on the road. Because when no matter when you're cycling on the road, you will use the space, right, of the road. So actually, they will have a cost train on the road. So how much impact of the cyclists on the road with the other traffic road? That's the thing we are looking at right now. Because the data. Because the data TFL has is very, very limited, very sparse. So how you So how you combine very sparse surveying data with the voluntarily contributed, so those of Ostrava you can consider the VGI dataset, and combine them together and draw a reasonable conclusion. That's this work, okay? And another one is the one on the right is the London have bike sharing scheme. I mean, many cities in Europe has as well. So the most annoying thing is if you go there, it's no bike. If you want a bike, when you finish your cycling and want to drop it, there's no space to drop it, right? So that's why there's lots of warehouse, actually they all warehouse in the city to try to move the bicycles around. But they can't make it kind of work more intelligent. And then do they kind of know when and where they should do the job for cycling? So that's the work I'm trying to show you here. So this is the red dot means to say they are not balanced at the end of the day, okay? And red as well. So this means they have a high demand for space. This one means a high demand for bikes, okay? So in this way, you can really monitoring the what we call the balance of the space and the bike very in real time. So you can really guide them. And at the end of the day, some stations you need to have balance. And they may not come precise the same time. So I think that's quite easy to understand. I think it's just this is just give you a very, very, very broad overview about all kinds of travel mode and what kinds of application we have been doing. Okay? There's not any formula in this slide because I don't want to bore you about that, but there's more things behind this or statistical modeling, more information than anything I think of, okay? And the cluster, people ask me, do you do any machine learning? I say, yeah, we do all the time, but I'll never say it because the same is only computer science claim they do machine learning, but that's all the methods behind it. So, moving to the next one, business intelligence, as I said. This is another big project funded by UK ICCSA. And so, this is one of the biggest big data projects actually funded in the UK. So, this is really where we have business partners. As I show you here, they're all contributing in different ways of their data. to our security lab, okay? So the, because all these data sets are kind of sensitive. So I think you guys should be familiar with the lens here. Jean-Louis is department store, like your icon, huge icon outside. And British Gas, you know, is energy company. Tesco supermarket, Boots is cosmetics. Sainsbury's supermarket, MS, you can be say, have food and clothes, fashion and many other things. And Argos is, I don't know, it's have lots of small electrical devices. So it's all kinds of different companies, okay? So the data can be mostly a consumer data set, okay? So that means it's a very rich data set. You have all the social demographic characteristics and also their home locations, and then all the behaviors of consumer, their different goods, energy, food, anything, supermarket, meals, anything you can think of. So it's all spatial temporal data set. Okay, I want to give you a few examples. So one example is this one. Can anyone tell me what this is showing here? Come on, have a try. Wake you up a little bit. So this is show says three stage and maybe not very clear. Okay, I'll give you a clue. This is Leicester Square, okay? You can be to London, okay? Box back circles is just here, okay? So this is a major, very busy road near Chinatown, okay? So you've been to London. So you can see, these are four sensors, okay? So smart city is going to be instrumented, okay? So going to be lots of sensor monitoring what's going on. So what is showing here? It's obvious, right? So it's basically how many people pass by it, the flow, 24 hours in these four stores for sensor location. So this is nothing new, isn't it? Not exciting at all, because you put a sensor, you find how many people pass by it, right? That's not science, okay? Science behind it is to say how people passing by it related to the people go to the shops and go straight. That's what we're trying to look at it, okay? I don't have an answer yet, but that's the book. Are going to work, okay? So that's the wonderful work going on. Another one. So what is this? Come on, you should know what this is.
Yeah. People.
Yeah. What is this?
Airport.
Yeah.
It's showing the presence of all those bicycles and other things in the different area.
Yeah. So what is this? What is this map? Come on, you must know this map.
Airport.
It's a Heathrow Airport Terminal 5. Okay? So it's a huge terminal. So yes, you can see already. So what this shows, it shows where the people come from. Okay? So based on the Twitter data. Okay? Of course, the challenge is this right? Fully right? How representative they are? There's lots of questions behind it. But this is better to it's better than nothing, okay? But there's lots of uncertainty behind it, okay? So what's the science? Science is yes, you have social media data, you may track the language. However, the major science, the real challenge science, is how you validate it. How good is your result, okay? Next one, advertisement, okay? So how you make your advertisement more targeted, more effective, okay? So now, this is example is one of the PhD as well. So this is just to show you some typical places in London, if you have been to London, okay? So King's Cross, right? Everyone knows King's Cross? Euston is very close to UCL, but Camden High is UCL, just somewhere here, okay? Soho is Chinatown. And it's called, Victoria. So this is the auto arena. If you go to big music show, big sports, you know, so go to auto arena. Okay, so that's something. Nothing special, okay? I don't think that's anything exciting. However, what exciting is basically, like right now in this place, you come here for the conference, okay? This is conference place, okay? I think tomorrow, I hope it's a low conference here, it's a university, okay? Not many visitors. Or because it's a summer holiday, not many students. So that's really, really, you may say it's university, but the major when the term is on. So have very strong you know, seasonality, I would say, like typical one here. So the same thing in cube stations. Henceforth, the major transport hub in the daytime, say, month 11, the traffic will come down. But still, some tube station going below the Euro stop, going to France or going to Belgium. So what does it mean? That means for tube station, they have characteristics changing with time. So what it means not only particular location, but also with time. So because I'm space and time. So that means right now you're going to be here at this moment and this particular location. So that means all the characteristics of a place actually is relevant to time. So it means what? It means whenever you want to advertisement, you want to be very relevant to the event. Right now, conference, you know, this group, interesting. Which search is going to be after my talk? Which room you're going to go to? After that, where is my lunch, right? What are we going to eat for lunch? After that, what's the afternoon session? Then later on, you go to 5 o'clock to 8 o'clock, 3 hours. You may say, oh, which place I want to look around if you haven't visited the town. After that, you give them a pause. So that means very, very strongly time independent. So same thing for tube station. So in this way, actually, when one make an advertisement, you shouldn't only have one map. You should have a series map because the activity in the weekend will be very different from the working days as well. And so actually, you can make an advertisement every hour. I think every hour maybe too much to manage, but say morning peak, you know, in between lunchtime, then your afternoon and evening. So you can make it. So that's what I'm trying to do here, okay? So actually we have more slides. So they just gave you some example. I think ethanol, you guys must know what is ethanol, right? So this is ethanol have a football stadium. So you may say, okay, so most time, you may say, but actually most of the time, this is his role. So most of the time, so it's sports, okay? However, it really focus on the typical time period. This is talk about proportions. Okay, that's the time period, yes. I think, yeah, in the weekend, okay? You talk a lot in the weekend because most of the premier football match either mostly in the weekend because they want more people to watch it, okay? But for the rest of it, actually, nothing to do with football match, okay? But in Heathrow, almost 24 hours, almost, you know, you're talking about transport. So that's quite natural, okay? So that's it. So of course another thing, so this is not, that was our explanation. So this is basically show you say how we do what we call a spatial profile of the stations. So really, what we really mean is that means when you make an assessment, you're not only looking for big stations. Of course, big stations, you always have exposure to more people. However, you got to exposure to the people really relevant to what you want your assessment. So that's what we're trying to say, you want to make an assessment for sports, for other things. You got to go to different places and maybe make it more specific at a particular time. So if you talk about fashion, probably not so relevant in case sports because people are busy with other things in the daytime, okay? Or in the lady. So that's target of the president, okay? So just give you some flavor of what can be done about smart sense. So now move quickly, how much time I want to do? So last one is another small work we've been doing is with health, okay? So health, this is showing, say, chlamydia, okay? So I don't know, you guys have, I think actually I was in a talk, some people talk about health, is talking about breast cancer, okay? So sexual health actually now is a challenge in Europe, okay, in UK. In the past 10 years, actually, all the sexual infections actually bring them back. Why? Guys, can guess why suddenly, because all the HIV sexual infections has already come up actually in the 1980s, but now coming back again. Why? Because?
Lifestyle,
because? Sorry? Refugees, okay, anymore. Come on. how many people are doing the trades, how many people on Facebook, how many people because of social media, because of the modern communication. So that's where it comes from. The huge, huge impact on the sexual life and sexual health. Okay? So this is the, so you can say it's a highly concentrated in the center of London. Okay? By the way, around the edge is called a great, around the edge is M25. Okay? We're very really defined in London, it's within the range. So what's the correlation between the chlamydia test with tweet? You can say this sort of correlation. Actually, they also are not 100%, right? So actually, we're trying to make use of social media data, but of course, it's not so processing to get this map, okay? It's not a pure trace, it's a trace relevant with irrelevant to sexual health-related activity, okay? So to get in that, and then put the relevance of them, you know, testing, significant testing, yes, it's very strong. And of course, not only that, it's relevant to the age, okay, going to be age active, sexual active age, and also your mind relevant, what we call the deprivation level in an area. So we, okay, that's maybe some little bit biased, but yeah, we do find, say, black young guy people, they do have more infection than normal people. So the age group, deprivation level, traits, so we can make some, put them all together, actually, we can make some. This is use neural network to make a prediction. Okay? So why we're doing that? Because we can want to say, okay, when would the positive repeat? When would be the trend? And what else the government can do? This is with Public Health England. So they do social campaign. So how effective the social campaign is, actually that's one of the projects I'm working with them right now. So because they have to try to have a campaign wave. So is the campaign wave effective? Is one campaign more effective than other? How to measure it? Because you put lots of money there. So that's what we are doing with them. Okay? So can, as you can see, I show you lots of sensors done ongoing work. Okay, a lot of conclusion, yeah, but that's it is. So that's that. And the next one is about the environment resilience. I know there's some people might be working on that. This is the FP7 project with several universities. My part involved with it is to say, can we access the landslide risk? So with historical data set. So this is in Italy, okay, in the loss of Italy, I don't know how far away from here. So basically based on so below landslide is relevant to vegetarian type, soil and global geological structure and also the rainfall. Okay? So based on all the historical observation, we use random forest methodology to do some assessment. So we lay them together with road networks. We can analyze so which road are more vulnerable to the landslide, and after that the people keep on working on that to simulate the impact if something happened. So what's the impact to the transport? What's the impact to the economics? Okay, so they can do all the cascading impact evaluation. So another thing about flooding, same thing. Flooding, you know, suddenly just coming quickly. So how we can make here some prediction? I know, as I said, prediction most challenging one is predict the peak. When the flood is really going to be here, when you need to move out of your house. Okay, so I think that's the challenge one. So we're able to manage to make a prediction so reasonably good within 3 days. Okay, based on yesterday, predict today, predict tomorrow and the day after. And let's also use supported by machine learning approach. The next one is event detection. So basically when something happened, so if you want to say, I want to monitor what's going on, but actually the truth is, if you know what's going on, you can always track it. But the truth is, I think the most interesting thing is that if I don't know what's going on, can I find what's going on? Okay. So actually, this is we use what we call SpaceTime Scan Statistic, SDSS, to detect events. So we can manage to detect very small sports event, as I said, football match, okay, you can detect it. Even very small train delays, you can detect it. And also other things, okay? So actually one company wrote to me and said, oh, can you tell me? I'm working for a company, mainly detect sports event, okay? Can you tell me what's your spatial temporal scale use in this method? I didn't know this is useful for them anyhow, so yes. So the crucial bit is what's your spatial temporal scale you're looking for? How frequent was it? That's the way, the crucial bit behind this work. Another one is quickly moving to the safety and security. So this is relevant to European Union, okay? So so what it's showing here is about 6,000 boats, okay, in Mediterranean Sea for 2 months, okay? So what are we trying to do? We have, they told us the 3 boats, which is showing on the here, they all confirmed boats which have been carrying immigrants, illegal ones. So within this 6,000, what are the boats possible? Be high-risk boat for the boats could be carrying the same thing, okay? So how you do that? So we're trying to use some machine learning approach again to identify possible line boats out of this 6,000. They could possible to be there. Again, so I couldn't confirm it last week, so what's the accuracy? I said I can't tell you because this really have faster than they try to track what's going on. And yeah, there's lots of gaps in the data, so yeah. But at least I think we will explore this method. Okay. So that's that. I think that's the final case I want to give to you. That's the project. It's working with Metropolitan Police. And it's about 4 years working with computer science, crime science, photographers. We're trying to do is make this, what we think we're proud of is we make crime prediction. But the crime prediction we're based on is not based on distance, not on grade. Really, what we are is level based. So why level based is better? Because people work on network, okay? And the prediction is much more accurate and easy to follow as well, okay? And the third, intelligence is not only about prediction. Actually, we can also advise them where to go, how you go to patrol, how you should do the patrol, okay? How you do the patrol, the criminals wouldn't find any patterns, okay? So then you can catch them, the risk higher, okay? And all the that, we can also need to give feedback. Do you really follow my instruction? Okay, I said you should go here. Do they really do it? Okay, so if you send your command, it's okay. Why this place? So do you have a high crime rate? Right. So you can say, okay, is our prediction right? Or they don't follow instruction. Okay, so how you make it better? So that's what we do. Okay, I don't know. So this, we have developed a system for them. So right now, the top one is how crime prediction is running in MacPolis. So I want to show you a video to kind of enter my
book. Metropolitan Police has been looking at crime mapping since about 2011. The reason for our interest was there were some very successful trials that were carried out by West Midlands Police and Greater Manchester Police that we thought were worth following up. We currently produce crime maps for 16 different kind of crimes across the 32 London boroughs. We produce them at 3 levels of geography, which maps to 3 levels of the south, which is borough and different city. We've been working closely with the University College London since we started this process. One of the things that they've been helping us with is making suggestions to improve the algorithm we use and the field of evidence. That British police forces are failing to adopt new technology in their fight against crime. So what went wrong, and how can the latest scientific research be translated into real crime-fighting weapons? In our opinion, existing commercial systems have 2 key shortcomings. Firstly, predictions typically highlight the most risky grid squares, rather than streets to control. Secondly, the accuracy of predictions has not been verified, which may discourage wide adoption. More importantly, the systems might not guide patrol in an intuitive way and may not give feedback on whether police officers patrol the right places at the right times. UCL SpaceTimeLab has developed an integrated platform for intelligent policing in an operational context. It emphasizes that intelligent policing is not only about crime prevention, but also how to act on it and how to evaluate it. The platform consists of three interconnected parts essential for policing: network-based crime prediction, patrol routing strategies, and performance evaluation. The crime prediction tool uses the street network as the spatial base for the prediction of urban crime. The advantages of this methodology are twofold. Firstly, street segments are well-defined micro-units, which allow risk to be estimated with much greater precision. Secondly, police officers patrol along streets, which means that network-based risk maps are easier to interpret. We have compared the predictive performance of the street network-based approach with its grid-based counterpart by examining the hit rates when applied to identical underlying crime data. The results show the network-based method outperforms the grid-based equivalent by a factor of between 1.5 and 2 for the majority of the coverage levels considered. After identifying potential crime hotspots, our patrol group planning tool can suggest efficient strategies for patrolling. For a given set of police station locations and a given number of officers, a control center provides movement instructions for multiple officers using an intelligent algorithm. Moreover, the control center records the routes of officers and is capable of reporting the coverage level of crime hotspots. Here, the redder color means more coverage. Finally, a toolkit has been developed to evaluate policing operations by analyzing the huge amount GPS data generated by police officers. Map matching techniques read live GPS tracing to infer exactly which routes have been taken by officers on patrol. This can be taken as a measure of how the supply of policing is distributed. By comparing this to the distribution of demand, such as calls for service, so the streets that need to be patrolled more frequently and oversupplied places can be identified.
Since we started this initial work, the university program has been developing a better and more accurate algorithm to help us improve the mapping process. What they've been able to do is produce a better set of maps that we can use to replace their current maps and give the officers a better way of patrolling. What we're hoping to achieve is to put police officers in the right streets at the right time. We're hoping that this has two benefits. Firstly, that it can prevent crime taking place in the first place. And secondly, that should a crime take place, this will just be a bomb and the rest of the world.
Okay, so that's more or less really ends up my talk to summarize it. So let's say I showed you quite a few examples around these four areas. So that's some of the colleges, my sponsors and my partners who I've been working with. So, keep on the last side. I'm happy to take any questions. Thanks again for your attention. Thank you.
Thank you, Tao.
Questions?
The point is that These are the guys that in the UK you will also find a lot of them from Africa, they are coming. In France you can also find a lot. So bio.com means taking any way to collect the data from the African region. Those are the major source for all those. Because this is not exactly the reality, what you are observing in the developed countries. The problem is anywhere else, and we must have to analyze them, because I'm also trying to develop a data center for collecting all those data on HIV/AIDS and something in my own industry as well. So I don't know that how can those labs is more focusing on those areas and by considering the data from. Thank you very much.
For the work we are doing, it's not only using the openly available data set, with the data might be possible to be active for Africa and for other countries. However, if you want access to the patient data, you need to have the collaborators. So that's the limitation we have. So that's why I've been working with the Yinan course. It's always says I shouldn't, okay? If you are able to access to the local government or any person who wants to work on it, yeah. So that's fine, yeah. What happened to you?
Thank you.
Other questions?
If you manage the big data, because I saw that you many fields, and so in what field you what are the problems?
You mean managing the data set? I think actually for all the data people say bigger data, yes, it's big, but the only really bigger data I would say is the voice card data, because I got a few months voice card data every day is about 6 million records, so that's really big. Other than that, the rest of the data is not really big. Even the police patrol vehicles we have, every second they have the data, okay? I have them for 2 years. It's okay, we can manage it. The only voice card data, you can't use any Excel file, anything. So we have to use Oracle as a minimum to manage it, yeah. Because that's, yeah.
Other questions? Okay.
I would like to thank you for your presentation. It's exciting sometimes. I would like to ask you a kind of ethical approach. You manage data, you build new information, and we understood that you provide also some very specific services for some specific commitment. It is the case of public security works and so on. What is your approach in distributing this information in an open way for the community, no? Because you can generate also negative reaction, conflicts, and so on.
What do you mean, say, for the adaptive community? Do you mean, if I describe prediction, and let's say someone use it, okay, so you may reduce the crime in this area, but you may have displacement in another area. Is that what you mean?
Yeah.
So actually the truth is, you're right. If only one place use it, you may have displacement. But if the whole police force is used to say nothing, so basically they generally reduce the opportunity for the criminals. So the whole community will benefit. Okay, so I don't know what you mean to say the sharing. So for me, for the research, I like to do research. Always, I told all my students or researchers, very simple. For PhD student, if you say you want to be upgraded now, very simple. If you can summarize, what's your theoretical contribution to the science? What's your practical contribution to the application? So then you are fine to study your topic. So that's the same thing for me, for my approach. No matter what I do, no matter say what the master you choose, number one, you got to choose to solve a real world problem. That's the problem, the hard problem, let me solve. Okay, then next, find the right method to solve it. If the method is there, you can just pick up and use it. It's also fine. But the truth is, probably, you will always find it's not readily available tools. So you they do need to do program to do further development for the tool to generate the solve that problem. So that's always my approach. So the contributing community, yes. There are sometimes the data will not be shared. So if I publish a paper, depending on what kind of data they also, most of the time, I cannot publish the shared data because I have signed the NDA, okay? And but we do publish a lot, okay? So any idea behind it is always available. The algorithm, yes. So my algorithm actually is, I teach my students an MSA course, and all the code has been used all the time.
Another question? Asked. Thank you for your talk. In your work about the smart cities, at the beginning of your talk, when you were presenting these London examples, I got the impression that London is a city without pedestrians. So how do you pick up and how do you put them into the system? Because we're almost not there. There were cyclists, there were public transport, everything. But yes. This is not the city.
I think actually, I haven't presented only mode, it's not the working mode. The reason I haven't have it is basically, I haven't really got a good data set about it. However, the example I show you is with the business intelligence, okay, those four sensors, actually they are monitoring the flows, okay, so they are the pedestrians. Actually, London is a very walkable city, I would say, I personally. And because one of the things they have been doing is, as you have been doing, is basically pedestrian doesn't take more lights, traffic lights. So actually, it's a much faster way in traffic lights in London than many, many major cities in the world. That's what they do, give more time for pedestrian. I think that's the difference. I don't think it's even here. But we wait quite long for the lights, but not, okay. So you're right, basically, I think they push more cyclists on the road, actually, the lots of issues, okay? I know people are thinking this is a fashion, but it does create lots of problems, lots of incidents actually happen with cyclists. But pedestrians, yes, so we don't shouldn't forget about them. You're right to say that.
Thank you. Okay.
So when you were talking about business intelligence, you mentioned the use of social network data and feedback and so on. I know that it is an open issue, but which is the direction of your research toward the validation of this data? Because normally people is not aware of the fact that this producing data used for some kind of research, so they can basically write everything in a tweet or mention true or false sentences and so on. So how can we validate this kind of data?
I think that's a very good question. I think that's one of the, I personally think one of the challenges of big data. Big data challenge is not an algorithm. It's not about managing data. Actually, it is about how you validate your funding, because that's quite difficult. Because all the methods we have so far is a conventional statistical approach. What does statistical really mean? It's based on sampling theory, okay? Right now, big data basically gave you is the partial of the whole population. That's what you got. How are you going to validate them? I don't have an answer for that, maybe. But that's something I think if you are researchers really think you're going to put out something big, I think that's one of the biggest topics I personally think with the big data area. No matter what you're working on, how you validate your funding, I think that is quite crucial. You may be able to do lots of aggregate levels validation, but that's what we have so far. Can we do anything better than that? Yes, I have students working on that, but no answer yet.
If you have other questions, you can ask Tao during the coffee break now. Now we can stop this session. Thank you a lot.